GM to help to support the event. You'll notice everybody in a blue shirt. We look around. Everybody who's here from GM, please raise our hand. You'll see people around the back. People here. These are really the people you have to thank for the new Stingray. These and many folks like them, literally thousands of people here in Kentucky, up in Michigan, and really all around the world. I've been working the last 4 years to bring out the Stingray and also the Z06. Usually I show a picture chart of everybody who's here, but you'll recognize everybody from their blue shirts today, and I think we have a very nice, snazzy, kind of silvery gray shirt for tomorrow. I want to make sure you guys got a chance to meet one of the important new members of the team, new since last year's birthday bash, and that's a new plant manager here at Bowling Green. Many of you know Dave Chapman retired, kind of went out on a real high note, but left fertile ground for his successor and a place in great shape, great product, great team here in Kentucky. And so I want you all to meet Jeffrey March, or my new partner, manufacturing.
Part of this team, looking forward to working with everybody in the years to come. And I know, like I say, they didn't give me one that we really needed to work on too much, so we'll definitely make it where we don't mess it up. We're very excited. A lot of folks across the street, as you know, are men and women of Local 2164 and the staff building everybody's dreams, and we're hard at it. We're working as fast as we can, building as many as we can, and building as great of a car as we can. So, thank you.
This next few days, be sure to stop by, shake his hand, give him a warm Corvette welcome. I hope he's around for quite a while.
Tomorrow morning, got our get to know you.
Tomorrow morning, you're doing a get to know you session yourself? Okay, perfect. So get to meet him up close and personal. And I'm sure he'd love to hear your stories, and he's going to be just as passionate about the Corvette community as the rest of us. So thanks for stopping by, Jeff. Okay, on to the show. We'll talk a lot about the C7, obviously, but we've had quite a run. Last year when we were here, we had kind of just introduced the Stingray. The convertible was still not quite out yet, but we were talking about it, and we had a huge amount of press coverage of the car. One of the most dominating performances of any new car launch in recent memory. We captured covers pretty much any time we had news. We were on the cover of newsstands, and it just continued throughout the year with mainstream automotive media and all sorts of other popular media outlets were covering the Corvette. All the coverage was extremely good, and I think you've probably seen a lot of the awards we've won. One of the first ones was the Yahoo Car of the Year. They talked about an amazing balance, superior performance, and great looks for far less than the European rivals, and a reminder that the bona fide legend of the American roads has no intention of pulling over. And I think you can tell from the product rollout, we're being a very aggressive coupe convertible Z06, coupe Z06 convertible. We're being very aggressive about getting Stingray season 7th generation Corvette models out there, and it's really reflected in our sales performance. We won Best Buy from Consumer Guide, and that's probably no surprise to anybody. I didn't want to put this on here. Harlan Mays put this on here. Of the year award was really excellent, And I didn't even know they did Man of the Year, Person of the Year award, so I was really shocked that they gave that to me. But I look at it as just another team award. There, like I said before, there was thousands of people working on this car, and it's just a reflection of the appreciation of all the work of all those people that they gave us both awards. Thanks, Harlan. Harlan puts a lot of this presentation together, and I get input 45 minutes before we come on. Auto Week, you can see the trucks, the Silverado, the full-size trucks that we introduced this year have also been highly regarded. Here's a cover of Auto Week where you can see stellar performers. So the truck won the award, and we won the award. You can see they talked about Corvette beating out two other very good cars, Mercedes S550, the Jaguar F-Type, which the Jag has been a huge new vehicle launch for this. And we almost did our launches simultaneously, so we had media coming off the F-Type launch, coming right into our vehicle drive, so they got a really tight back-to-back in perfect driving situations. And to come away with the award over the Jag, the expectations are really high, and it's a really excellent car, and actually a lot of the concept behind the car is very similar. Cars to beat them was extremely gratifying. I know everybody here is a Corvette fan, but the car is really reaching out to people who haven't considered a Corvette before. You can read the bottom line here. One staffer summed up his C7 experience thusly: every person who says they're a car enthusiast should have a new Corvette sitting in their garage. And we've got lots of anecdotal stories of people coming in, you know, telling dealers they're canceling their Ferrari order, their Porsche order, even bringing in Bentleys for trade, all kinds of things. You know, people that we've never really touched before really are touched by this car and really feel strongly that they have to have one. Just goes on. Road Track, Performance Car of the Year. No surprise, our trusty 2014 Stingray earning top honors. I take this a little bit. I've been working on Corvettes 21 years, and they say it sounds melodramatic, but virtually all our drivers agree the C7 isn't just a Corvette. Corvettes have always been great cars, in my view, but they're seeing now this car is kind of fully realized. It's got no weak points, not anything you pick at particularly that's a weak spot in the car, and so they're really embracing it completely, saying it's become a brilliant everyday car. I always thought it wasn't really an everyday car with the luggage room and the long-term driving comfort and fuel economy and all the things the car did well. I think they're coming to appreciate the car. Car and driver 10 best. We actually fell off the list for a few years, but we're back on, and I think pretty close to the top of their list. Here's an article they did. This was the first truly comparison article where they put us simultaneously with the 911, and the 911 was all new last year, so very new and fresh on 911. And so the Corvette had a back-to-back competition to beat the 911, and you can read the comments, but it's new and possible to ignore. The 911 simply disappears in its presence. And if you actually, no car and driver, they rate all the attributes kind of methodically of the car. If you look at where they rated interior and exterior styling, they rated the Porsche better for that. But yet they have a comment like this that says, at every stop the Corvette was swamped with people taking pictures, asking questions, simply standing in awe. And, you know, some people wrote in saying, well, how can you say that and not give Corvette the nod for having the best styling? And I can't remember their comment, but they said something like, a lot of people eat McDonald's hamburgers, but that doesn't make it fine dining. So, I don't know if you guys read that, but I think anybody who's spent around time around the Stingray or driven one knows the reaction you get from people, all kinds of people, young kids, old people, men, women, you get a very strong reaction from the about the car. North American Car of the Year is one of the bigger awards. That's where media from around the world vote on what they think the best, most significant, most important new car introduction is. And it's awarded actually at the North American International Auto Show at Detroit, right on the eve of the show starting. And we had a fantastic day because not only did the truck win its category as Truck of the Year, the Stingray won the Car of the Year. You can see a bunch of people you may recognize standing around the yellow car over there. This is in downtown Detroit. They gave us a great trophy, and it was my honor to represent the whole team and pick that award up. So that caps off a really unbelievable year. Couldn't ask for it to go any better in terms of recognition for the car, people appreciating the work that we've put in basically silently for the last 4 years. Couldn't say anything. We'd come to these events. First question every time, what's the C7 going to be? Couldn't answer it, couldn't say anything, but rest assured, you know, we're here listening to you guys, appreciating what folks want in their car and trying to put as much of that into the new C7 as we could. So if you add it all up, you can see all the awards. I should talk about all of them and be here all day. As much fun as that would be for me, you can see where the most big. Making the claim that we're the most awarded car of the year. And I think if you look back, because there's more awards given out now than there used to be, I think it's probably the most awarded car in history. We haven't researched that, but I think it's quite likely to be true. How many people have seen Captain America? A few people? We got, it's kind of a funny story, but the Corvette, there's a lot of Chevrolet products in the movie, and the movie had actually wrapped by the time we introduced the Corvette to the world. And I got a call from our chief product placement guy. He said, we need a triple black Stingray in Washington, and you can be in this Captain America movie. And of course, at that time, we weren't in production. The cars we had were like pre-production cars, prototypes running around. And so I said, no, we can't do it. And he calls me back and goes, no, you really want to do this. You really want to do this. You've got to find a car. He even went to the point, he said, you can personally deliver it. This is going to be Scarlett Johansson's car in the movie. He said, you can personally deliver it. You can come up with a car. So we went back and I didn't do that. I think he did. The guy calling me, I think, is the one who did. So we went, we scrounged around, we found a car, got all cleaned up, made it to look pretty, and we shipped it down. And so, actually, you see the movie, the car appears like in just a couple of scenes. It's like right at the beginning. And we just managed to get the car down just in time. But they did appreciate having it in the car. In fact, when the movie premiered just a couple weeks ago in Michigan, they invited a bunch of people to come out and see the premiere. And they handed me rolled up one of the movie posters. And I should have brought it down. And it was the guy who had asked for the car. He handed me this poster and said, you're going to want to keep this. And it was wrapped in plastic. I just thought it was a regular movie poster. But I opened it up when I got to work the next day. It had been signed by all the cast. So that's hanging in my office right now. So that's pretty cool. So you can see the kind of recognition the car is getting. And being the star in some movies, and I expect you'll probably see it in a few more movies in the near future. So that's kind of the highlight of the year. We usually go through kind of sales and content discussion here, so I think I'll let Harlan go over that.
Yeah, a lot of people like to see how the orders are going. You can see the Z51 package is doing very well, very popular, and also the 3LT, which is our top level package, is also the most popular. Other interesting about colors, we have the big three, Torch Red, Black, and Arctic White are the top colors. On the interior, it's interesting to see, and we're all gratified, how well the Adrenaline Red, which is really a sharp interior, how well that's doing. Got some great fans. One of the things, a little bit of an announcement today you might not know about. You can see when I brought green a few beautiful color, although not the highest selling color. So if you really want that color, hurry up and don't wait. Don't wait anymore on that color. And I think for 14, it'll 14 will be the, it'll go on through the end of 2014. And it won't be back for 15. And we don't really have a slide on this, but I guess I will tell you that I think you'll have an idea of what it looks like by the name of it, but the color we're going to have for 2015, again, it'll be a little bit late introduction, it's going to be called Daytona Sunrise Orange. Some of the other options, of course, the automatic, about two-thirds of the cars have the six-speed automatic, about one-third with the seven-speed manual. You can see the different chassis. The standard chassis is the most popular with the Z51 and then the Z51 magnetic ride. The exhaust, performance exhaust, 82%. One of the interesting things to, on here, of course, see the red brake calipers do well. On the black wheels, this has been the first time the black wheels actually, I know there's been a lot of forum debates and people, it's like, you know, Republicans and Democrats sometimes, but black wheels versus the chrome wheels. Black wheels a little bit higher now than the chrome wheels for the first time. So we'll see how that plays out. And then one of the things we're very proud of, you know, the race we do, we love racing on the track, but the other race that we do is in the showroom. And you see, we have really established our dominance once again as the leading luxury sports car in the market. Sports cars in this class hold in the U.S. is a Corvette, and you can see a little versus our other competitors further down the line, much less. And all, you look at that 170, it's getting close to triple the sales of last year, so it's pretty cool. And then, of course, about racing, we've got Doug Behan here, he's going to do the presentation later, but any chance we get a chance to talk about, we're very proud of how C6R, the sixth generation Corvette, ended in great style, winning the ALMS in the final year of the ALMS, winning the manufacturers and drivers and team championships. So very proud to defend that. And also the Grand Am Rolex, the Daytona prototype car, also winning the manufacturers champions. And Chevrolet also won manufacturers titles in NASCAR and IndyCar as well. So very good year for Chevrolet and Corvette racing. And also very proud to mention, the guys came through in Long Beach. We got the first win for the C7R.
Talked about a lot last year. off the C6 are, put them right, baked them right into kind of the fundamental architecture of the C7. That starts the C7 off as a better place for the race car. And then when you look at the succession of cars we've had, all the way back from C5, C6, C7, that evolution just keeps going. Doug will probably talk about it. He calls it cascade engineering, where you take the lessons from the track, you apply them to the street car, then you have a better baseline for your next race car, then you advance the state of technology again, and you just keep moving forward with each generation. So we've been really proud of you guys have seen the success on the track. C5, 6, and 7, very, very consistent, arguably one of the most successful race programs in racing. Really proud to continue that, keep moving it forward and taking it up and up, really setting the bar for the industry and the world in terms of this kind of strategic approach. You guys know, and you've seen the structure for the new C7. It's a paradigm breaking structure, all aluminum, latest manufacturing techniques. It's so secret we don't really let, if you take the tour of the museum, you kind of get a look at what's going on over at the plant. We don't really take people through the body shop because we're manufacturing that frame in a lot of high-tech ways. So we don't want people to get hurt, but we also try to keep our exact details of our manufacturing process somewhat secret. The new frame is the foundation for the car, and in many ways helps the race program get a lighter and stiffer car. The race chassis is 40% stiffer than the previous generation, and first time out, Doug Mick talks about it, you know, the drivers knows immediately, stiffer is better when it comes to both street cars and race cars. You hit the curbing, the body doesn't flex, the wheels just move up and over the curbing, stay planted on the ground, and that's how you fast. It doesn't matter if you're on the street or the track. Now, some of the folks here may say, well, isn't the race program constrained by weight? What good does it do you to have these really lightweight parts if you have to make the car meet a weight threshold anyway? The answer is it gives you a lot of flexibility in the materials you use in your car. So if we can make parts lighter on the body structure, it enables the race program to more tailor where they use other materials. And I have an example here. I usually wave around really lightweight parts. I wanted to wave around a heavyweight part today. Because the rest of the car is so light, the race program can actually use heavyweight materials in places where it makes sense. So dropping the center of gravity is really important. And so the race program can use heavy materials in underbody bracing. Help bring the center of gravity down. And I brought an example of that here today provided by the race team. This is actually a bracing going under the car. It's made of tungsten. I don't know how many people know what tungsten is, but this is 3 times denser than steel. So when you pick this up, it's as dense as gold is, if you can imagine that. A gold bar, this actually weighs 10 pounds, even though it's extremely small. And tungsten's expensive, but if this was a gold bar, it would be $200,000. So if you want to feel like what a $200,000 bar of gold feels like, this is what it feels like. It's amazingly dense. So that helps the race program bring the center of gravity of the vehicle down. That helps with the handling performance of the car. So it's another way where we're driving technology into the race program that helps them out, helps make the whole system work together better on the racetrack. Direct injection, we announced last year direct injection helps on street car, helps on race car, gives the drivers more precise control over the throttle, and then gives you better fuel efficiency, higher compression ratio, and so possibly eliminating pit stops, and also, you know, on the street car, it gives us really good fuel economy, given the performance levels of this car, and excellent range. So we really never had the street car and the race car so close together. When you see them on the racetrack, you see that the aerodynamic bodywork and how slick everything is. You really see it reflected in both the C06 and the C7R. So So that brings me to the Z06. I wanted to give you some of the highlights, although many of them have been previously published. But I'll give you some high-level rundowns. It's going to be our most capable Corvette ever. And I said this publicly, but it really shocked us when we took this beautiful yellow car here, but really beat up a looking prototype, put together for the first time right out of the box, had computer-generated chassis tuning, so springs, spars, and shocks. First submission tires from Michelin, early calibrations on the engine, so it wasn't producing as much horsepower as it's going to produce. And Jim Merrow took that car out on our Milford Road course last fall and broke the track record. First time out of the box. That never happens. It's a function of better computer models, but it's also a function of technology transfer from the race program. So our aerodynamics are spectacular on this car. Michelin's tire technology, even though it's a first submission, fantastic, and that's why we're able to go so fast so soon. Typically, and this is the last two generations, C5 and C6, when you first have your prototypes out, they're a lot slower than your best effort on the previous generation because you've had so much time to develop the car and get every little ounce of performance out of it. And then when you start over again, you take a step back, and then you've hopefully baked enough goodness in that by the time you develop it, as good as it can be, you've surpassed your previous best. So to come out of the box and be as quick as this car is very encouraging. I mentioned the aerodynamics. It's got more downforce than any production car, not just GM cars, but a lot of competitive cars. We've tested at our wind tunnel, far and away, both downforce. You know, a lot of manufacturers talk about downforce, and we're really talking about less lift. This is true downforce, where the faster you go, the harder the car's being pressed onto the road. We have early estimates on the engine performance, 625 horsepower, 635 foot-pounds of torque. This car is really torquey. You remember the LS9, the C6 CR1 has 605 foot-pounds of torque, so we're going to be at least 635. So like the Stingray, the engine feels actually more powerful than what the horsepower numbers show. And you've got a lot of area under the torque curve, so any gear, any speed, you've got tremendous throttle response, tremendous performance. We're having two transmissions, both our manual 7-speed that people are starting to get used to, we introduced last year, and then our all-new 8-speed paddle shifting automatic transmission. We've got a lot of new technology. I talked about the aerodynamics, tires. We always are looking to advance the state-of-the-art in materials. The frame is already aluminum with more carbon fiber applications. One of the ones that hasn't gotten a huge amount of play, but actually have a part here. This is a lightweight part. I like the lightweight parts a lot better. But this is the first time anybody's ever done this. This is a section of what we call the driveline assembly. So this is the structural piece that attaches the engine in the front to the transmission in the back. The whole thing is about 6 feet long. Historically, it's been made out of aluminum or steel. This time around, we're making the big center section, like I said, it's about 6 feet long. This is just a piece of it for convenience. Cut, and it's spiral wound carbon fiber with aluminum bell housings on each end. Now, people have done prop shafts before, so what you normally think of as the spinning component that transmits power from the front of the car to the back of the car. That's relatively easy because that's just a pure torque that you're transmitting. This is actually a structural element that reacts all the loads. So when you do a big burnout, this is the thing that keeps the tires on the ground and reacts that enormous load as the tires try to stick to the pavement and the car is literally trying to pop a wheelie. And the thing that's keeping it from popping a wheelie is the engine mounts way in the front of the car. So you're actually reacting that whole load. This thing sees a lot of torque, a lot of bending, a lot of different loads. And so to be able to do this in carbon fiber for the first time is a big technology win. So you guys are free to come up and take a look at this. It looks like aluminum on the outside because it's wrapped in thermal wrap for heat protection. Because this runs down the center tunnel above the exhaust. And so we need to make sure that it doesn't get too warm. So another example of technology first in Corvette that helped make the car lighter, make the performance better, and it's carbon fiber, came from aerospace, came from racing, and we're always looking for ways to try to use that technology to make the car work better. So everything you look at on the Z06 is functional. If you walk around the car, I don't know if Kirk, how many people were here for Kirk's presentation this morning? So quite a few. I imagine he covered some of the stuff. Everything as you walk around the car is functional. The stance, the width of the car, the air inlets. I don't know if you mentioned the grill in the front. It actually flows more air than no grill at all. Did you talk about that? That's the first time in my career where that's happened. And some would admit it was a physical impossibility that you would actually get less airflow through the front end by removing the grill entirely. But that's what's been accomplished. It's kind of miraculous, actually, and very lucky for us that we found that little window of physics that let us do that. So I mentioned the downforce, and as you walk around the car, you can see all the aerodynamic aids, front and rear, to help balance the car. It's not just downforce, but you have to have the right amount front and rear, so when you're going really fast around a corner, you don't want one end to be getting a little light relative to the other end. So if it's just downforce is not good enough, you got to have the right amount of bounce front to rear so the car stays neutral going around the corner, even at very high speeds. So everywhere you look, even in the back, you can see that we've made the whole car quite a bit wider. This is the first time where we've done our so-called wide-body cars, where we've done a new rear fascia. Typically, you kept the narrow fascia and then put like little splash guard pieces around the wheel openings to preserve the rear fascia. This time we took the same taillights and moved them out 3 inches, made the whole back of the car wider, helps cover the tires, it's better aerodynamically, and gives the car a really impressive visual stance from the back. You can see how aggressive the rear spoilering is, and I don't know if Kurt mentioned this, but what we're showing here is not as aggressive as it's going to be in production. The car is still being developed and will be developed throughout this year, so it's going to tracks around the world, and we're finding that we need even more spoiler on the back end. So you'll see that thing actually growing a little bit more in height before we get into production at the end of this year. So a lot of refinement, a lot of tweaking going on right now, and it will throughout the course of the year before we get the car in production. We're going to offer it with 3 levels of aerodynamic performance. And really, it's a function of how serious, how you're going to use the car. The standard Z06 will have a splitter, like if you were familiar with the previous generation Z06, relatively small splitter and a less aggressive spoiler on the back end. And then as you move up, you get more aggressive aerodynamic treatments. You see the front splitter gets bigger. It's got little winglets on the outboard side, and the rear spoiler gets bigger, and then the top level that comes with the Z07 package gets the most aggressive front splitter with big winglets on the outboard edges, and actually an extra piece, which I don't think I can see it on this car, a transparent piece that's adjustable for people who are truly hardcore and want to set the car up for the track and make small adjustments to make the car handle exactly the way they prefer. So we got kind of one for everybody. It's not one size fits all. You can kind of pick the look that you like, what goes up your driveway. If you got a steep driveway ramp, it can handle the low aggressive front splitter. You can kind of pick which fits your lifestyle and the way you're going to use the car. There's a few tweaks on the interior. I don't know if you guys got it. We didn't even count it amongst our awards, but Corvettes historically have not been known for their interiors. And we brought out the Stingray last year. We were talked a lot about how one of the first jobs we wanted to do, Ryan Vaughn, I know, was up here earlier. First thing we wanted to do was really improve the interior, and that's really getting home with people. We hear both from customers, and then Wards, this last week or two, gave us one of the best automotive interior awards. So it's really nice now to see that one. On the Z06, you get a flat bottom steering wheel with a carbon fiber accent on the lower spoke, and it says Z06 on there. Carlos is going to talk a little bit about the option model lineups on the Z06, but you can still get the, of course, the competition sport seats. We're not forcing them on Z06, but they are available. Some people will still prefer the touring seats, the standard GT seats, as the most comfortable option for them. But of course, we expect people to opt up for the competition seats in that car. I don't know if you noticed, but we previously said that we expect this car to be 0-60 in under 3.5 seconds. Today I'm shaving a tenth off. So as we get closer to start of production, we'll get more and more fidelity, more and more confidence as we complete the development of the car. It's an important tenth though, because going from 3.5 seconds 0-60 to 3.4, if you remember our published time for last generation, CR1 was 3.4. We are now saying that we expect to be able to be that good or better with this generation CO6. So it'll have unbelievable supercar performance, but without the typical supercar compromises. We talked a lot about the engine. This engine is an amazing piece. It takes all the advantages of the small block, very compact size, very efficient. Super high power density when you look at the volume of the engine itself and the mass of the engine, what's really important for a sports car as well as a race car. This engine's only an inch taller than the normally aspirated small block, but it's going to put out at least 625 horsepower. It's got all the best stuff that we know how to do and have been working on for years and years. So I think people are going to be really impressed when they get in this. We're going to be the only 600 plus car that still offers a traditional three pedal manual, and one of the best ones in the world, our 7-speed with rev match. And it's going through some improvements. When you feel the rev match in the 2015 car, the Z06, it gets even better, it gets even quicker, it gets even more precise in the matching. So really a world class traditional manual transmission for people who like that. And then our new 8-speed paddle shifting automatic, which was custom designed for this car, for this Z06, this package, this engine output, everything that we wanted out of a transmission that would give you both really snappy shifts for street and track, competitive with any DCT you compare it to, but also a good traditional automatic feel for people who like automatic transmissions. And really benchmark fuel economy. This transmission is extremely efficient. So choice of two. We heard in the last generation car were Z06 and ZR1. We only offer with manual transmission. We have lots of customers telling us, well, you know, we can't agree. You know, a couple wants to buy a car, and one wants a manual, one wants the automatic. We really want the high performance, but we can't agree on the transmission, so we're buying a Grand Sport. You know, so we really want to give people exactly what they want. Arlen talks to us all the time about you know, the best business strategy isn't to piss your customers off. You really want to what they want. You know, that's generally a good business strategy. So that's what we're doing here. So I talked about the 8-speed, great for fuel economy, and really a very impressive box from, take the pictures. I think this is all out on the internet anyway, so don't worry if you've missed it. Technology, when we do technology, and we talked about a lot of you last year at the Stingray, we want to use technology to expand the performance envelope, but not just for numbers. We really want to make that performance more accessible to more people. So expand the envelope, but make it easier for regular people to get closer to the edge of the envelope and feel comfortable doing so. So it goes into all of our thinking, whether it's the transmission, the way we set up the transmission shifting calibrations, the way we calibrate our stability controls, you know, the chassis controls, the way we develop our tires. It's not just enough to have a sticky tire, you want one that's progressive at the limit. We also want the car to feel tight and responsive, and like everything reacts linearly to what you ask it to do. So you get a proportional response from the steering wheel, the brake, the gas. Everything reacts exactly in a very measured way. You don't get any surprises. So A big part of that, we talked about it last year, was the aluminum structure having the car very, very stiff, just like the race car drivers notice. Anybody who's driven a Stingray or gone back and forth between a Stingray and a previous generation car, you know it's night and day in terms of the steering precision, the structural feel of the car. That's a big, big part of keeping you confidence behind the wheel. I already mentioned the carbon fiber torque tube, having that very stiff, light component, real important part of keeping the whole vehicle weight as low as we possibly can, and bringing new technology, lights and technology to the car. Magnetic selective ride control is standard on the Z06, and that's kind of the premium shock technology in the world. We've pioneered it ages ago, and it's just gotten better and better and better. We've learned how to calibrate it better and better and better. It's got a lot to do with great balance between performance and ride and handling. It's a great compromise on a car that rides decently, but also handles in a very inspiring, confident way. And then we introduced last year the electronic limited slip differential. That'll be standard also on the Z06. Calibrated for the Z06, calibrated with the wide Michelin tires. And that, people really don't appreciate it, but that has an enormous amount to do with how the vehicle handles, making it feel really responsive, but also very confident in transitions. The car is very tough to get loose. It just makes you feel like a hero behind the wheel. We put all the good stuff standard on the Z06 because we really do a lot of work on integrating those technologies. So it's not enough just to have them and then work on just that one thing. We put everything in the basket and then work on it all together so it all works seamlessly and supports each other. So it doesn't matter if it's steering or transmission calibrations or powertrain calibrations or chassis controls. There's all these different computers on the car constantly talking to each other, and what they're doing is trying to make your driving experience better. We spend a lot of time working on that. The driver mode select that we introduced last year, all that stuff will be custom calibrated for the Z06, and because we have all the content standard, we are able to make the most of those individual driver modes. I mentioned we have a lot of work to do yet this year. We went to some warm weather tracks this winter. The snow is just clearing in Michigan. And so our own Milford Road course is now open for business, and we're gonna spend a lot of time this summer honing the aerodynamics, honing the, like I mentioned, the chassis controls, the final tire selection. Still working with Michelin very closely on the final compound, final construction. We're even changing molds. We got pictures in here, but we're still, even at this point, changing the tire tread pattern for the Z06. So we got a lot of work yet to do. We were essentially forced to show the car for two reasons. One is the race program was done simultaneously with this car. It was going to be on tracks this year, so you can see how similar they were. We weren't going to keep any secrets once the race car was out there, so everybody was going to see it. And then also the other big reason is you see the cars ahead of time with all the camouflage on. We put the vinyl tape on, we put all the canvas around the outside. That screws up the aerodynamics so badly that you can't really do your high-speed testing with that stuff on. It's like driving around with a drag chute. It just messes up all the aerodynamics. So for us to really do our work, we have to have a clean body. We have to take all that stuff off. And so we really have two very strong reasons why we had to show the car as early as we did. But we've been very honest with people and say we've got basically a year's worth of work to do and expect to go into production end of this year with many volume deliveries really starting in earnest first quarter of next year. And nobody believes us, but we keep saying that if we could afford the old Z06, even though it looks like a ZR1 Plus in a lot of ways, if you could afford the old Z06, you'd be able to afford this one. And we didn't lie last year. We did raise the price after start of production, but we just hold it for start of production. That if you could afford a C6, you could afford a C7. Finally, I'll just touch on the most track-oriented option on the and this is what we did in the previous generation. The Z06 had a Z07 performance package for the truly hardcore. So this is the Michelin Passport Cup 2 tires. And this is actually a tire where we're still fiddling you'd say there is no tread pattern, it's a slick, but there is tread on it, and we're still working on exactly the final configuration of that. That'll have carbon ceramic brakes, the biggest ones we can fit in the wheels, and then level three aerodynamics I talked about with the adjustments. The ceramic brakes save 18 pounds, so for somebody who's going to be the hardest core, we are continuing that option. So, and that'll be available with manual or automatic transmission. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the option lineup. I think I'll let Carl do that.
Yeah, some of the getting more of the detailed options. On the interior trim levels, it's pretty similar if you're familiar with the Stingray. We have the three trim levels. The main difference with the Z06 is the head-up display is going to be standard on all the Z06s. You can see the different levels. The 3LZ will be the top level. And one of the things we're showing here in the picture, there's two exclusive colors that are Z06 only. It's the blue leather and also dark gray as well. And then the wheel options, you're going to have four wheel options available for Z06. We have the silver and the black on display here. A lot of people saw pictures of the blue convertible that was at the New York Auto Show. That has the new Spectra Gray with the machine groove. That's a kind of a cool wheel because you get some of the brightness and then some of the sinister look as well. And of course, chrome wheels as well. And then again, the new colors, we're going to go from Cyber Gray to Shark Gray. And I mentioned the yellow one already, the new color. And when the car was shown at Detroit, here's the first Z06 award already, Auto Week's Best in Show. Of course, they're looking forward to driving it. And if you wanted to get the first Z06, I'm sorry, that's already spoken for. Our buddy Rick Hendrick, $1 million. You know, there's all these video out. I saw somebody picked up his first convertible where he's walking around, the spire in the dome area. I think that foul wallet caused that sinkhole. And one of the things, if you missed it, we did announce that this all-new high-performance 8-speed automatic will also be available on the 2015 Stingray as an option. So we're going to transition from the 6-speed to 8-speed for all Corvettes as well. And there's also, here's some new stuff you probably haven't seen, some new options for the 2015 Stingray we're going to have. Some new wheel options from the factory for the Corvette Stingray without Z51. We're going to have a black wheel available since it's doing so well on the Z51 package. We also have some new machine wheels for both standard and Z51 with the black machine look, which are pretty sharp. And then also we have some new accessory wheels. You can see the Torch Red car in the back has the new red stripe wheel. There'll also be a yellow stripe wheel. And then we have a new, we call it Motorsports Design, accessory wheel as well. That'll be available in polished and black. On the interior, continuous improvement. We really, I think, are still state-of-the-art by far with our interior page cluster reconfigurability on the 8-inch screen, the different themes. But in going forward, we have a new tour theme. A lot of people like in the tour mode where you get the data screen and wanted to see a speed, kind of a nice general purpose page there that you could use. And then some new things on the sport theme, we have a horsepower pocket gauge option. And then we also have a new page, if you have the ELSD, which will give you the status of the electronic limited slip and also the kind of your eventual retraction, the wheel slip percentage too, and that'll be available as well. I mean, included as well. And some other new options. Again, this is probably the first time we've talked about this. As you notice, the Z06 come with the carbon flash badges, kind of the dark badge option. And so that'll be an option for the Stingray as well. So the Z06 will come with the carbon flash badges. You can get that if you like that versus the bright look. And maybe if you're getting black wheels, it might go well. And then another thing, again, we always say that we try to listen to everybody and things that we have. We have two new options coming for the exterior vents. We have one if you want as an alternative for the carbon flash. We're going to have a shark gray of that option. It gives it a different accent. Or you can also option up and get body color vents if you want more of a monochrome look. And on the convertible, actually the Show Car New York was the first car we showed with this, has carbon fiber tonneau inserts that will be available on all convertibles, so it'll be a good match if you have the carbon fiber interior or the carbon fiber ground effects on the car. The navigation and performance data recorder will be joined together. I'm going to talk about a little bit more about the data performance data recorder in a second. Also in the 3LT will include the suede upper trim, and then the NPP, the performance exhaust. So many people got it, we're just going to include that with C51 going forward, so C51 will get that automatically. And then also the new OnStar with the 4G, you know, Wi-Fi hotspot in the car will be standard. Now, in addition to that, a lot of people have been asking about these cars in the back that we have, which we showed at the SEMA show last year as concepts. We have the convertible, the silver convertible, which we call the Atlantic Design Package. That is going to be available as an option for 2015. And the ideas behind this was really, you know, we have a lot of personalization that you can do with the Corvette, a lot of accessories. We thought for some people they might want a recommended combination or something that's predetermined to a uniform theme. So the idea was to do that. Kind of an East Coast convertible and a West Coast coupe, or however you want to look at it. So the convertible will be a Z51 2LT, 3LT. You can get other colors besides the one we showed, but it has, it'll have the Z06 style splitter included, a good graphic, the shark gray accents, the chrome torque, the wheels, and some, a lot of the Stingray accessories, Stingray logos, accessories, and the custom luggage included. So it'll be like a complete package. And then on the Pacific car, coupe again, a little more aggressive than the coupe, it'll be available in torch red, black, Arctic white, blade silver, or the new shark gray, and that'll come with the red stripe wheels that you see there in the car behind us, as well as the carbon fiber ground effects package, red calipers, competition seats, and again, some of the other accessories. So these are two things that'll be available as check the box packages. So we're very excited about their design packages, and that's new for 2015. So that's what those cars are, and we're actually, the announcement is coming out at, just came out. If you know you connected people, you should try to jump the gun. But 10:30, I think the announcement went out that those are going to be officially available for production as 2015 model year packages. So that's good. So I want to talk a little bit about the performance data recorder. How many people saw Steve Kozlowski's presentation yesterday? Okay, good. So Steve's here. I'm going to summarize a little bit for you, though, what he did, if you missed it, but he did a great job covering it yesterday. This is something we're very proud of, to be the first really fully integrated system available from any manufacturer on the Corvette. And looking back, you know, we were looking, you know, this is something that we've had kind of, we're thinking about for a long time from the beginning of our program. You know, looking at the trends, you know, the customer events, track events, you know, the HPDEs through the museum and the driving schools, you know, you have downtime between the sessions and you really like to spend that, you know, improving your driving and learning how to be a better driver. And also, you know, there's the trend of people like to share their experiences on internet forums, YouTube, social networking. There's also a big influence, you know, with the state-of-the-art driving simulators where they'll give you instant replay, Gran Turismo, Forza, and things like that. People, you know, there's a lot more integration of electronic technology in the car, and we know that Corvette buyers want the latest technology in their car. And the car is also can be, you know, it's more than just a car, it's an experience, it's also a way to become a better driver. So we really wanted, you know, to have the ability to become a better driver, share your results, share videos, and even share, for even if it's not so serious, be able to share some fun experiences with driving as well. So it is an industry exclusive system. It allows you to record and share your driving experience. We developed this with Cosworth Engineering, And there have been our supplier for Corvette Racing, so it's another example of racing technology brought into the production car. And again, this is going to be included with the navigation system on all 2015 Corvettes. Now, some of the key components to the car, to this package, is an HD camera. It's integrated with the rear view mirror. And a lot of people didn't notice, but if you look at any Corvette, even if all the Corvette Stingrays have been on, if you look at the blackout on the windshield, or where the rear view mirror is from the outside of the car, there's a little notch in there. Not too many people notice that, but that is really what that's for. That is for where the camera is mounted. And then the telemetry recorder, there's two sources of data. We have a dedicated GPS receiver that had to be 5 times faster than a conventional navigation. Because when we first got this started, we thought, well, we have everything. We have the GPS already in the car, we have this data, and we started working with Cosmo and said, no, to make this a really, truly track analysis, I think it has to be much faster than we did, and that's why we have an integrated box. And also, there is, in the glove box, there is a dedicated 8 SD card slot. So, that is your data, so when it's on, it only records onto the SD card, it doesn't record anywhere else in the car, and you have to activate it to record it. So, a lot of people ask me that. You own the data, you don't want it, you can delete it, take the card and throw it away, whatever you want to do, but it's yours. We introduced this at the Consumer Electronics Show, and we actually won 3 awards for Best in Show in the automotive category. So it's very, very exciting. And Steve doesn't know this, but we got like a little clip of him going through this. So if you missed yesterday, this did a really good job explaining how to work the PDR, so I'm going to try to run that right now.
Hi, I'm Steve Wesolowski from Cosmos. I'm here today to help introduce the PDR, the Performance Data Recorder. This is an industry-first combination of video, audio, GPS, and performance data recorder available for the track and street. The Performance Data Recorders enable Stingray drivers to record their driving experience both on and off the track. The PDR will be available in the 2015 Corvette. From the infotainment home screen, you'll see the new PDR icon. In 2 button clicks, you can be recording your driving session. Launch PDR application and hit the start recording button. From this screen, you can either stop the recording or you can go out and mark the start finish line. Going back to the PDR home menu, you have several choices. You can stop your recording, you can define your start finish line, you can review your recorded sessions, or you can choose the various video overlays. The options are to have no overlay, no data on your screen. You can go to Sport Overlay, which adds a few channels of data. Speedometer, gear position, RPM, lateral Gs. The next choice is your Track Overlay. This adds more features and data. It adds a GPS tracking map, so you can see where you're at on the track. Also, you get brake and throttle application. Final overlay is performance timing. If you're out on the drag strip, you want to record 0 to 60, 0 to 100, or to your quarter mile drag race times, you can do that using this screen.
Once you've recorded your outings using the PDR, you can review the video on the infotainment screen in your car, or you can pull the SD card out, take it to your laptop, and review the video, or import the data into a program called Cosworth Toolbox. Inside Cosworth Toolbox, there's several ways to look at the data. One of the easiest and most user-friendly pages is the stats page. Here you'll see every lap from your outing. This is a great overview to see what you've done from lap to lap and look for your drive consistency. On the video page, you can look at both laps, both your current outing and your reference lap, either side by side, or you can look at them on the chart page. You can see the video recording. You'll see the overlay that you selected on the PDR in the car. On the right-hand side of the page, you'll see a chart. This chart shows accelerator, braking, and steering angle. This is a great way for you to compare and see what you can do to improve your lap. On the corners page, you'll see a satellite image of the roads or the track you were driving on, and you'll see statistics, maximum speeds, steering angle, speed, gear number. You'll also see where you lost or gained time relative to your reference lap. You also have the option to look at the corner with a chart showing you the data from that lap. There are many more combinations of video and data that you can look at using Cosworth Toolbox to help you improve your time and have more fun with your Corvette Stingray.
working with Cosworth to get this in production, and he really represents our Tractor Street because he used to work on the race team, now he's working on the production car, so just like the feature from the Tractor Street. And these are my backup slides in case the video didn't work, so you never know, right? I always better say than sorry. But basically, there's the four different script, different overlays that you can have, and actually, we'll have, when we go into production, we'll have a link through the Corvette website to the toolbox so you can analyze all your data. Now, I had the honor of being at the New York Auto Show last week, and we introduced the fourth, basically, kind of completes the seventh generation Corvette family, and a lot of people have been, again, like Tad said, we listened to you guys. A lot of people said, why don't you do a Z06 convertible? And we did the seventh generation and the structure. That was one of the key things. So we wanted to have a structure that was capable of doing a Z06 convertible and actually stiffer. The Z06 convertible actually is 20% stiffer than the fixed roof Z06 and Z01 that we had previously. So the new Z06 convertible is seen here in the behind you. It's going to be available about a year from now in spring. And it will be the first Z06 convertible, except, as far as we know, with a little car in the corner there, when they did a 199 Z06 option 1963 Corvettes, and there's only one that we know of that was a convertible on there. So, so it's not the very first, but it's close. Again, the car will have, just like the Stingray, it will have the full power top. It can operate up to 30 miles an hour, and you also can operate it remotely with the key fob because, as Corvette drivers, we don't like to wait for anything, so I want the top down before I get inside. And the other thing, a lot of people ask me about this, yes, it will be available with the Z07 performance package and the carbon fiber ground effects and all the same options that you can get on the coupe version. Will be available on the convertible. And the New York show, we had the blue car, the Laguna Blue car also, and that has the new wheels, so we talked about the Spectre Gray. And the interesting thing was, I don't know if some people saw a lot of the pictures of the silver car, we actually had three student photographers. So, you know, people are probably tired of the standard, you know, PR, you know, marketing images. We kind of do the front three-quarter, rear three-quarter. So we had three young students come in and say, you guys shoot, you know, photography students, shoot that. And that's been on our Facebook page on Corvette, Facebook/Corvette, that you can vote for which pictures you like the best of the silver car. And I mentioned before, we have the new blue interior. This is the blue car has the new dark gray interior as well. And I think we're done. This is the top board. And now you know the whole Corvette story, seventh generation. And so I think we're probably everyone's all happy and satisfied. But I can't imagine. We've been a little over, but we have I think we have a few questions we can take from Tad and I.
Well, the race car has obviously a lot of different rules, including full roll cage that helps contribute to the stiffness of the race car. We've talked extensively about the motor frame being 60% stiffer. That's kind of convertible. Carl mentioned 20% stiffer. That was a convertible, new convertible compared to old fixed cars. So some people get confused. Why do you say 60% sometimes? Why do you say 20% sometimes? Bottom line is, extremely stiff convertible. We were never able to make one stiff enough before to react to loads on a car like a Z06. Stiffer springs, stiffer bars, you know, aggressive shock value. So you have to react to loads. You need a stiff structure to react to, just like the race car does. So the race team takes, you know, a lot of the foundations we've created, and that makes it a stiffer.
Thank you.
back there.
Eventually they'll bring it.
That's going to be.
I don't know if any aluminum torches are. Do you steal gears?
You win the lottery.
Absolutely.
What gears are you talking about?
Well, I got to be careful.
There's no aluminum gears. Like the new transmission, it's all steel. It's hard steel.
40 by 40 garage.
You'd expect that to steal the deck. Okay.
Make sure you put over here.
Constraints on Z51 at the performance package. When will they be lifted?
Constraints on Z51. Right now we're producing about half of Z51. We're working with our suppliers to maximize. We know a lot of people want it. We're working with our suppliers to maximize the output. If we get the lab station to the constraints, it's going to come in small increments. It's not going to go from constraint to so right now we're making, we've already added a bunch of capacity. We're making four cars. Then we were able to planning to make either Bowling Green. So all of our suppliers are ramped up to the max that they can fill. And so it's challenging to also have higher penetration as you can just top of the higher overall volume. But eventually, if
they're commercial releases, things are
going to be better. There's enough demand at the beginning. And I think things get down. Questions about ride quality lineup. Obviously, the standard FE1 car with the larger sidewall tires has an overall best ride isolation. Z51, you trade some of that off with people more slice handling, higher limited capability, robustness, and then the CO sales takes that to the next level. Much higher, much bigger wheels and tires, more aggressive calibrations. The reason we made magnetic selective ride standard.
Get it.
Side of the track is taking a different traveling different distances, and so they're kind of fighting each other. So there's a stick slip phenomenon. It doesn't hurt anything. It's primarily at low temperatures, you know, kind of once the first rapid car is driving in the morning. Please, everybody, he can explain all about the mechanics of the rubber, but when you put very sticky tires, competition like tires like that, then you also do a tight turn circle, you're going to find that it's inherent to the car, it's not.